it is 1994, and I just bought my first 14K4 modem. The internet is just a black screen and a blinking cursor. The whole experience is actually quite boring. One night, when I'm visiting my favorite bulletin board, suddenly something very strange happens. Suddenly, out of nowhere, words start to appear on the screen. I look up to see what's going on. It says, "Hello, can you find what you're looking for?" I'm terrified. The computer just spoke to me. This never happened to me before. I walk out the room, I take my dog for a walk, and I thought about it, and I thought, that was not the computer, but it was a person talking to me. 20 minutes later, I return back to the computer, get my act together, and then reply, yes, thank you very much. Too little, too late. You can imagine that this was not my most successful chat, but it was my first online conversation, and it made a deep, deep impression on me. And I thought about it a little bit longer, and I figured that chatting with somebody on a distance via a computer could actually be a lot of fun. And it makes sense, right? Because we humans are made for the conversation. A 2010 study from the University of Michigan learns that having conversations have the same effect on your neural functions as intensive brain training does. Another study from the Brigham Young University in Utah learns that having frequent social interactions improves your survival rate by 50%. In other words, having conversations is not only healthy, it's crucial for you to stay alive. This proves that the conversational interface is the most essential interface of all. Back to my little history. Soon after my first chat experience, social media came around, and you all know the big success of that grew immensely. And today, popular messaging services process about 40 billion messages per day. And on top of this incredible amount of conversations between humans, I foresee a second form emerging, and that's the conversation between humans and machines. I have a question for you. Who recently called the number of your bank? Right. You get a friendly voice on the phone, it asks you a couple of questions, and then directs you to the right person. I have another question. Who ever talked to the personal assistant on your phone? Right? Wow, quite a few. It's pretty impressive, right? You see, in all of those examples, you're talking to a machine. And I foresee that those conversations are going to be much richer and much deeper than until now. And there are three major trends that are driving this. The first trend is smartphone adoption. Today, 2.5 billion people have a smartphone. It's your own personal interface to the internet. And the special power, actually, of this interface is that by asking questions and giving answers, the whole information exchange gets really personal. This allows machines to create a unique personal profile of every human connected. The second trend is cloud computing. Now machines have the ability to store an unlimited amount of conversations and have that accessible everywhere, anytime, any place. The third trend is artificial intelligence. Having context is essential for a machine because words can have a different meaning depending on who you are, where you are, and with whom you are. In a bar with your friends, you have a different conversation than when you are with your mother at home. This is important context to have. If you think about it, machines can really learn from what you say, how you pronounce words, and how you respond to questions. And by combining that insight with, for example, your location, they can determine if you are with friends, with family, or colleagues. So now that all ingredients are available, let me take you to a world where everybody has their own personal assistant. It pays your bills, it does your shopping, it manages your calendar, and it just makes sure that everything runs smoothly at home and at work. Your kids have their own personal assistant as well. It helps them with their homework and teaches them all kind of practical stuff like brushing their teeth. How would you feel about a machine like that? Having a digital friend definitely has its perks. It's always available, it always listens, and it just does the things you want it to do. Compare that with your human friends, right? They're always busy, they're unpredictable, and when you really need them, they're just not there. Of course, humans and machines are incomparable, but I foresee that the difference will get smaller on a social level. Soon, machines will not only carry out simple tasks, but also fill in our need for attention, desire, and even love. And you know, I think that's a good thing, because it can solve big issues like loneliness. But at the same time, it puts a big responsibility on technology providers, on regulators, and on developers, because we will share our most intimate feelings with machines in our conversations, and companies will over time really understand what's driving us. So companies must be very, very clear on what they do with the information that they gather and what their commercial intentions are. You know, Lenin said, trust is good, but control is better. And good companies will give you the control to manage your own personal data and what they share. But the biggest responsibility relies with you. What kind of relationship will you have with machines? How do you stay in touch with your human friends? How do you make sure not to alienate from the world around you? Have you ever really thought about those questions? Looking back at my experience in 1994, it was my first reaction that a machine, another person that I talked to. So the whole relationship between humans and machines is more natural than you think. And it will get harder and harder to make the difference. So please promise me you don't lose your friends around you. Please promise me you keep looking after each other. Please promise me to think about the questions I asked and get the answers for them. Thank you very much.